some results according to so-called series of lectures on microstructure. What I mean about microstructure? In this case, I will discuss some applications of some microstructure, real microstructure materials such as a form, some composite structures, functional gradient materials, and especially some materials with a fractal or rough surface. In literature, various mechanical mathematical model to describe such microstructure materials, some of them are listed here. Macroporic materials, micromorphic models. There are another situation. You can also introduce some continuously distributed dislocations, which dramatically change the property of equations. For example, the property of compatibility equations are not very known. Also, another generalization of material with microstructure is a case where you consider the surface stress or something different near the surface should be taken into account in some cases. And also, and final, last but not the least, the materials of second grade, of third grade, and some gradient theories of plasticity. The main goal of my lecture is to discuss how the not, let's say, non classical properties of bulk materials may be inherited by two dimensional equations of plates and shells. The previous lecture gives us good examples, many such generalizations from the classical beam theory. In this case, I will discuss, because this problem is too big to be presented here, I will discuss some two cases, macropolar materials and the reduction of three-dimensional macropolar materials to two-dimensional ones. And the second and last case, material of second grade. Some of problems here, solid stresses will discussed by Professor Eisenbach. Okay, nice picture of some forms here. It is a naked form which is used in some electrochemical applications, for example, industries, etc. It is interesting that such materials are used as elements of symbolic structures in sandwiches or control. In any case, for example, the producers, manufacturer, these forms as a sheets. From this point of view, from the generic point of view, we have some kind of mechanical problems related to bending of such sheets made of such materials like a form. Another example was presented by Professor Eisenbach. He showed some macro arrays, and this problem is very popular because it is related to some kind of modification of surface, because it is properties of such fiber arrays can change dramatically the surface properties and so-called self-cleaning materials, for example. If you have some situation and you can use such materials, for example, with some surface damages, and it's very useful for some cases. And a few words about why at least I like the shell and plate theory. If we consider some kind of state of generalized continuum models, okay. And from this point of view, the point of view of generalized continuum models, the theory of plates and shells, very rich theory. Because it can present, for example, if you like second gradient models, okay, to look at the classical curve of plate. In this case, you have the independence of strain energy of the second derivatives of deflections. In this case, it's second gradient elasticity, because we have some dependence on. If you like harmonization, okay, in the theory of shells and plays, there is a special procedure. Special procedure related to derivation of two-dimensional tracer, so-called smooth-thickness integration procedure. It's, in this case, it's similar to representative volume method, but very special integration because we have some kind of new integrate over this situation. If you need, if you like Cosra models, okay, here also have that independent rotations since the rest of time. We have moments of couples, stress couple tends to be hit. Like micromorphic models, we also have some additional degrees of freedom, for example, working functions, which describes the change of cross sections. Also, some good examples among the brilliant geometry. Also, no place like I mentioned, also type-order series of plays and shells, which in some sense also some gradient models of plays and shells. And now, the parts of lectures given here, short introduction. I will start with the two-dimensional formulation of plate and shell equations. Then I switch to 3D situations of micropolar elasticity. Then apply to these three-dimensional equations through the thickness integration procedure. I will discuss how to define the average of integrated or the thickness three-dimensional equations with two-dimensional ones. And finally, switch to gradient elasticity, which is similar but not the same. And using the same procedure, we obtain something else and some conclusions. Here, I will use so-called Cosra theory of plates and shells, which was formulated first by in works by Cosra brothers, and later was recognized in the paper by Erickson and Roosevelt. Where they propose to describe this two-dimensional equations. They use so-called direct approach. They consider the shell or plate as a two-dimensional surface is attached, non-rigid form of directors. This approach was discussed by Lindner in many papers also in different approach was by Levin, and some of these models are summarized in the book by Rubin, and also in the book on linear problems of elasticity by Stuart Tampman. In these books, in these works, they used so-called direct approach. It means that we have two-dimensional continuum and apply some basic equations and apply they two-dimensional constitutive equations. But it is an interesting question how these two-dimensional equations relate to three-dimensional equations. Because we understand that there are only some exceptions when we can consider the real body as a two-dimensional one. At nanoscale, for example, or via membranes. But here, we have also, we can consider some three-dimensional, simple three-dimensional operation, how we can reduce this different procedure. For that was given in some papers. It's usual methods of defining theory of shells or plates, asymptotic methods, variational methods, integration through the thickness, and some others, non-convergence also. It is interesting that kinematically this theory of shells is the same as theory was proposed by Levi Simons and also in the school, Polish school in Gdańsk, with Professor Petrashkevich, Kushilevsky, and some others. like 6 degrees of freedom. Three translations which describe some translation of base surface of the shell, and three pneumatically independent rotations. Unlike comparison kinematics, where we have only 5 degrees of freedom, here we have the full micropolar kinematics. Okay, let us consider the two-dimensional case. For the sake of simplicity, I will consider the plane geometry to avoid some complications with the curvature and integration using the curvilinear coordinates. And also, I restricted myself by linear case. In general, the transition to non-linear case or curved surface can be done in some papers, in some places, but there are some technical complications. Okay, we have that surface, and we formulate the equations describing the equilibrium of any part of the surface. We choose any part of this plane surface, say M stars, and formulate the integral form of the equilibrium conditions. There are two vectorial equations. The first says that total force vector should be zero, while the second one says that total torque should be zero. They expressed due to distribution of surface forces and directions acting on the contour of this force. And moments are expressed also due to moments of forces and also distributed powers or moments acting on the surface. It's the same for the contour. Here, x is the position vector of this surface. Using the standard theory, we can represent this contour along the traction vector and bubble stress vector using three-dimensional stress tensors or bubble stress tensors. They are also called resultant stress and bubble stress tensors. On top of the equations I give here, we have the same vectorial form of this equation, nonetheless, it's a surface with the energy number operator. The form of these vectors are presented here. There is interface coordinate, we have the 6 equations. It is exactly the same equation which was presented by Kram-Sapp. With only one exception, because we have also 6 equations. This equation describes so-called leading moment, fractional leading moment. It means that in this theory we have the also possibility of making compound this leading moment. For example, in some sense it's not necessary, in some cases it's not necessary to make compound such full kinematics, but in some sense, for example, simple example, if you try to describe the interaction between intersecting shells, you need to use this. And in this theory, there's no problem to describe such multi-coupled shells or reaction shells with the beam, etc. We introduce the linear strain measures given here. This is the roughly speaking, it's two-dimensional Coserac strain measures. A is a two-dimensional Newton tensor given here. A is a curvature tensor or Lewis tensor known in the literature. These strain measures are not communicating the stress measures to the stress and bubble stress tensors. It means that, for example, if you multiply the equilibrium equations by some function W and another function omega, we obtain the principle of virtual work, which is formulated here. We have the stress power given here and also the work of external forces. So it means that we have a big formulation of this problem. Now, we can speak property case, it means that we consider the whole properties of this plate can be invariant under rotations. In two dimensional case, the general representation of stray energy for the stray energy, depending on two non-symmetric stray measures, I mean it here, where there are 8 elastic parameters, say alpha and beta, and beta describes the bending properties of the shells, while alpha describes the in-plane elastic properties of the shell of the in the case of shell, we also can consider such a simple space of acidity of legend, also in the case of shells. Here, I should mention that there are some additional constants given here. This alpha 4 is similar to constants related to shear stiffness factor in the theory of pricing dominion theory of plates, while beta 4 is also has the same sense with respect to couple stresses. And usually, the formulation for relation for the stress tensors and upper stress tensors, they are expressed via the table by this of strain energy density, and here also here. And from the, because then we assume that energy should be positive defining function, from this it follows some inequalities for elastic modeling. There are some equations. And for example, this was seen by Koshevsky, Koshevsky-Makovsky. There they produce some factors which are similar to shear correction factors, but two shear correction factors. And some recent papers, Koshevsky, Makovsky made some numerical calculation and also investigate the influence of the choice of this shear correction factors for some problems numerically. Now we switch to three case. I will use the same procedure. I formulate the integral equations of equilibrium. It means that I say that for the equilibrium should be total force and total force should be zero for any volume of matter over body. Here I introduce mass forces density fraction in sense of three-dimensional elasticity and couples density in sense of three-dimensional metropolar elasticity. And from this integral equations, this big form of equilibrium equations using some standard assumptions, I obtain the local form of equilibrium equation presented here. Because it's scalar equations or vectorial equations, static boundary conditions is given here, pneumatic boundary conditions are given here. We assume that in the case of pneumatic boundary conditions, we assume that they're given in some sort of part of surface is given the displacement, some translations, and three-dimensional equations. Three-dimensional strain measures are given here, it's the same as, for example, in the book of Ellinger or book of Nowatsky. Then we consider the plate-like body. We have the body, but with finite thickness, and assume that our volume element is some cylindrical volume element, and we apply these two equations to this volume element. Roughly speaking, we will integrate through the thickness of this element. And what we have in this case? Now I have this, I quoted some expression for this, and my idea is to switch from, to transform these expressions using the three-dimensional integrals to two-dimensional integrals. In this case, I can transform this total force and total moment in such a way. Here, the, these brackets denote the integration of the thickness, and it is some kind of algebra. We integrate this and update something else. Here we have some integration of the faces of plates on the lateral surface of plates and also for some. But here we have already have integration over there for some part of base surface as a dimensional case. Introducing the new notations, we can simplify these equations and find that they have such a form. If we introduce that, roughly speaking, we combine all external forces and campus in some complexes. Given here, we have some loads, some couples, and find these equations. If we compare these equations, this expression for total force and total moment vector, with the first introduced two-dimensional one, we can define that stress resultant tensor given here can be represented by this formula, by the stress, couple stress tensor can be represented by this one formula. This means that if I use such definition for these quantities, I obtain the same equations, exactly the same equilibrium equations. And it means that the previous two-dimensional equilibrium equations are exact consequence of three-dimensional equilibrium equations of micropolar body if we introduce the two-dimensional stress tensors and two-dimensional surface couple stressors by such formulas. Now, the more complicated moment key point of this theory is that now, okay, we have the equilibrium equations, but now we should explain how the two-dimensional constitutive equations relate to three-dimensional constitutive equations, because in the later we introduce some, let's say, some parameters here, which are given here, for example. But what is happened if we consider? And to do this, we will replace the following procedure. We express, we try to integrate over the thickness, the two-dimensional constitutive equations, and consider what is happening in this case. As usual, in the theory of shells and plates, we assume that this tensor's stress is zero, so we can express this strain, component of strain tensor in such a form, substitute to the constitutive equations. Here, we do some modified constitutive equation of three-dimensional body. And now we can also, using these two formulas, we can try to average two-dimensional constitutive equations. And finally, we obtained these formulas. What I should say, the form of these equations is quite similar to the two-dimensional one. They difference only by optimizations. But there are some terms which cannot be described by two-dimensional equations, because here we have something which cannot be explained as a two-dimensional quantities. Without such underlying terms, we should use some constraints, kinematical constraints. It's not a big problem, because in any theory of plates or shells, it depends. First known, well-known Kirchhoff-Raff hypothesis, kinematical hypothesis, replacing. And we assume such constraints here. And after assuming such constraints, we can say that these constraints are satisfied and fulfilled if we assume such linear approximation of the three-dimensional vectors, three-dimensional displacement vector. We introduce interpretations here is a linear approximation in respect of the thickness coordinate and three-dimensional rotation vector can be expressed as such a form. And here is an important thing that here we have the same functions. But these soft coordinates, which are related to drilling moments, should be introduced independently. Then we obtain the same form of constitutive equations as when we can consider two-dimensional planes. If we assume that these strain values given here are exactly the same as a two-dimensional one, then we obtain the same constitutive equation, but with some additional material constants given here, material parameters. And comparison this two-dimensional direct approach and this integration through the stiffness, we obtain some relation between these parameters of stiff two-dimensional parameters of stiffness and parameters of three-dimensional passerable. There are many formulas, but for example, let's consider the bending stiffness, what is called bending stiffness as a theory of plates and shells. Here it will be such a quantity or in more suitable notations can be presented here. This factor which is given here is a standard classical bending stiffness of the classical kind of plate. But it is multiplied by this factor, and everywhere is an additional length scale parameter reflecting some macropolar properties of material, of three-dimensional material, with respect to bending. So we see that this bending stiffness of macropolar fluid has some difference with classical planes, and this difference can be represented in this graph. So we can see that this difference is important when the thickness of the plate is has the same order as this length scale parameter. This we have such kind of hyperbolic behavior in the plate as well as thick, such as because it was mentioned today by Stefan Liebig, there are not too much experiments on the macropolar materials. And here we use some macropolar constants presented by Lakes. He made some experiments with foam, his foams using some size effect, and he found some modules, a model of macropolar materials of this foam, volumetric polysterol foam, which appeared here, and this he introduced such engineering parameters, shear modules. Also, on ratio characteristic lengths for torsion, for bending, coupling number, and also Fourier ratio, which is similar to Poisson ratio. And some numbers are given here, presented here. If we use this quantities, use these numbers, we obtain the expression for our parameters, elastic parameters of our shell in plate theory. What should be noted here, given in this table, this form described by macropolar material. Here is the form described by usual material. It means that I neglected the macropolar properties. This means parameters are zero. In this case, we felt a difference in such. Okay, so you can see that, for example, bending parameters, you have some dependence of the thickness of plate, as usual dependence. Here we have more interesting dependence, which are linear with respect to thickness, but multiplied by a very small coefficient. Because this coefficient depends on the length scale of the material. So it is, and for the most they predict the same results, it has the same behavior. You can compare that here, it has the same numbers, but in the case of polar material, it has additional terms. And before I switch to another variant of theory, what I should sum. Local conclusion. We start from the, we compare two-dimensional equations of macropolar shells, compare it with three-dimensional equations, apply to three-dimensional equations some technique may be different, but using some assumption, we obtain the same equation as two-dimensional case. In this case, we have the difference is only in some elastic modulus. It's the same theory, micropolar, three-dimensional macropolar material transformed to two-dimensional macropolar materials. With some different constants, but it is something good. What happens if we consider some, I don't wish to say more complicated model, but another model of reactive elasticity and apply the same procedure to this model and find some the same manner, try to find the two-dimensional equations. What has happened in this case? I guess that it's not too much time to explain the gradient elasticity, but in this community it's not necessary to explain why this theory is important than before. And I briefly mentioned some names in this field, and also it was presented in the paper by Minden and some others. Tupin Distant in 16th and presented by Ehrlinger, modified by Fantis. Some masters yesterday discussed the difference between Fantis and Ehrlinger models of gradient elasticity. The constitutive equations are presented here for Ehrlinger model and for Fantis model. And for Fantis model is proved the so-called Fantis theorem. Askes also explained this theorem. It means that everything of Fantis model of gradient elasticity is that one can use the known solution of classical elasticity and obtain the solution of gradient elastic boundary problem, because this problem in this case is uncoupled. The procedure is given here. We consider such equations, classical equilibrium equations with such definition of stress tensor, with such definition of strain tensor, and then we find the true displacement field using this equation. When I say that we try to find the solution, it means okay, we have the equation, but also we can use some kind of boundary conditions. But from general point of view, this raw effective theorem gives a good idea to how we can derive the gradient theory of plates. We see that stress and upper stress tensor and stress tensor can be expressed in such a form. And if I use the same procedure through the thickness integration and then use this raw effective theorem, I obtain the same similar equations of video equations. It is a bit modified. A bit modified, it means that we have some kind of additional multiplier. Here is a surface Laplacian operator meaning here. But somehow it's some kind of, let us say, that it is a Fantis type of video equations. Using this constitutive equation, a problem to generalize this constitutive equation for another case. First of all, we can use this advantage statement to equations. We can say that, okay, because the in-plane behavior and the out-of-plane behavior can be different, we can introduce two length scale parameters in this case. And also apply to this stress tensor and power stress tensor in such equations. From now, it's obviously how to use to formulate the Eremeyev time classification. It's also can be done in similar manner as presented for the case of B. It's also can be done for the case of voyage. Of course, in this case, you can modify these equations as you wish to add these multipliers here and here, and investigate all the specials. Of course, because the Eremeyev equations are modified by non-strong non-local equation, it means that there is some integral constitutive equations. I can introduce some kernel and obtain some different, it will be third order gradient elasticity, fourth order gradient elasticity, etc., etc., etc. The problem is that in this case, one should say that something about the boundary conditions. How we can take into account the boundary conditions? From the mathematical point of view, it's maybe simple because if I know what is at the surface, I can use natural boundary conditions. But, for example, in Minden paper, it was written that okay, if we assume the power stress is zero on the surface, it means that we introduce some kind of surface energy related to this boundary layer. And in this consideration, we also omit such fact when I will integrate the equation, I also should do something with the second derivative with respect to thickness coordinates. It means that in this case, I obtain something similar to surface elasticity, similar but not the same, which was considered by Paul, by Dr. Model. And okay, and finally let us consider what is happening in some simple case, because we have complicated equations, not as happens if you consider that bending of square, let's say square plate. And in this case, we assume that we have the only transfer slow at the cap is zero. We assume that length scale parameters equal each other. In this case, we have some functions representation for solution. Equilibrium equations are reduced to three equations over. From these equations, we can obtain one equation for which will be used later. This is where one equation expresses the reflection of the paper, the blade. And what is happening in this case? If we have the non-gradient theory, it means that length scale parameter in both Atlantis and Eremeyev types theories are zero, we obtain this equation. This equation is standard equation in the case of Reissner minimum theory. For example, the external loss is constant. We have the equation is known more than 150 years skill of bending equations. But here we have these equations. How our modifications of shell and plane theory modify the equations? I found this type of game theory gives us these equations. It means that we have the sixth order partial differential equations here. Eremeyev time gradient theory gives another case, because this is more complicated term on the right side of the equation. And for example, if Q is a constant, we have no difference. It's exactly the same as the normal explained when this cantilever beam acted in elegance or not any influence of non-locality, let's say non-locality. Okay, it's the simplest case because okay, if I can difference in the sum, more complicated, lower equilibrium of those differences. Here. To conclude, it's my conclusion to discuss one, let's say, mathematical tool to derivation of two-dimensional equations using the three-dimensional equations. It's a known tool, known because we use it, it's quite natural tool because we use the integrations through the thickness and obtain the exact two-dimensional equation. And this means we can derive micropolar models of plates and shells, which are exactly the same as a in general the same as a macropolar three-dimensional case, and also we have some modification in the case of gradient elasticity. But in this case we have some kind of complications because we have some data, some so-called surface elasticity related to this derivatives, higher derivatives for the thickness. And of course it is interesting, the future step of this such configuration is interesting because, okay, in linear phase, we have some tools. What is happening in a linear phase? In the case of nonlinear elasticity, it can be done with some complications, but can be done. At least in general, you can write some formulas. In the case of gradient, nonlinear gradient elasticity, it is not, I don't know how to do it just now, but it is. You can say that, okay, we know, don't need the nonlinear problems maybe, but in the case of plated shells, it's maybe important because they are very flexible. The flexible structure means that you can. At least you should take into account some geometrical nonlinearity because it's a large rotations at least. And of course, if the question is how we can consider some additional factors, parameters like that, so temperature, diffusion, etc., etc., etc. Some references related to our models in the case of plates and shells is given here. That's all. Thank you for your attention. It's like some special numbers, so apply some very isolated load, which leads to this term should be significant.
It depends
on the problem. In this case, it will be such boundary layers. same if I consider some free boundary conditions, it's also maybe some free boundary layer solution, type of solution. Is such boundary layers important or not important? It depends on the problem in general. Because, okay, maybe not important because of long structures, but if you consider, for example, fracturing, for laminate plates, it's dangerous parts.
Okay,
so it's also, if I have some, if I have the pump, some two solutions, this boundary layer, that boundary layer, maybe it's help us to say that this is more dangerous, that it's less dangerous, because some kind of stress concentration.
It seems to me that then you have a solution in the Eiffantis equation and no solution in the Eiffantis equation.
Yeah, but it's a good question, but also here it's the problem with if I collect the concentrated force.
Just piecewise compound.
Yes, but okay, I differentiate piecewise. Let's say it has a sine function, I pay delta function, I differentiate it twice, I obtain different second cross derivative. In this sense, it's in sense of how Francesco said, in sense of distribution.
Yes, as you have the fourth derivative on the left hand side, you can correct the problem, we have a continuous solution.
But it means
why in the third equation here you have the same order of derivation with low sign in the equation.
Yeah, but okay, that's true. Mathematically, it means that we have some different requirements for the volume. They should belong to different functional spaces. In Kirchhoff's theory, maybe there is one function here. Or some. Here is L2 space, it's enough in Kirchhoff equation. Here it's not enough because it's some open something. Well, here it should be more smooth.